zikuwa mboga nyingi. Halafu wote tunakaa kuzunguka Kilimanjaro. Halafu nasema tuombe.
Yes.
Tunafunga macho. Tukisema amina. Mashambulizi yanaanza. Kila mtu anachukua, hatutumii forks.
Yes.
Mungu ametupa forks. Hallelujah. Wakati tunatumia natural forks, unakwenda kwa Kilimanjaro. And by the way, kuna haja ya maisha kuwa mazungu wako. Ukitaka kufurahia maisha, angalia watu wanavyokula ugali. Suffices for the day. Kuna wengine wakienda kwa ugali wanaanzia juu. Wanashusha, wanafanya nini? Makata. Lakini kuna mwingine akienda yeye anakwenda hapa pembeni. Anachukua anaka. Wewe angalia kwa watu wote wanao. Ugali unapata shida. Lakini hiyo ni kula ugali sawasawa, okay? Kwa hivyo kila mtu anakwenda kwa namna yake.
Yes.
Takle ugali. Kisha kata ile, kuna mwingine anachukua vile vile. Anapeleka kwa mboga. Lafa anapeleka. Kuna mwingine anakata, alafu, anafinyanga, anaviringa. Mwingine anaviringa mpaka inakuwa laini. Anachukua ile mpira anapeleka kwa mboga anachukua. Sasa kuna wengine wanafanya kitu na ile mpira, si mnafahamu? Anachukua ile dole alafu anafinya ile mpira, ha, inakuwa na shimo kubwa. Sasa wewe ukiwa na mgeni wa namna hiyo, hakikisha mboga inatosha.
Yes.
Kwa sababu kuna maneno ya Kiswahili, huyo ambaye hafanyi shimo akienda kwenye mboga anatovia. Lakini huyu anaye shima shima, akienda kwenye mboga anakomba. Kwa hivyo hakikisha una mboga ya kutosha. Lakini yote hiyo ni kula ugali. Hallelujah. Alafu wote tunapenda kwa mdomo. Sasa ukiweka kwa mdomo pia inapendeza. Na wengine akiweka kwenye mdomo anaminya na ulimi. Inakuwa flat. Hiyo inatosha na weka ndani. Kwa hiyo ukifungua tumbo yake ni kama anajenga nyumba. Matofali baada ya matofali. Lakini kuna wengine akishaweka mdomoni anatafuna. Anatafuna. Sasa tunatofautiana, wengine kidogo, wengine katikati, wengine. Niliwaambia tuna sister mmoja kwenye family yetu. Yeye kila siku ni wa mwisho kutoka mezani. Kwa sababu anatafuna mpaka anasahau anakula. Yeye ni kutafuna to just choose, 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 choose. Lakini wote tunafanya nini? Tunameza. Mekundua lakini katika maisha, katika kula. Wale wanaotafuna wanafaini chakula zaidi. They gain most from their food.
Yes.
Wale ambao wanameza meza tu, nyingi inakwenda chooni. It's not economical kumeza meza. Unapoteza pesa unapeleka. Wale wanaotafuna, actually, chukua chakula ambacho kina chumvi wala sukari. You will discover, the more you chew it, the sweeter it becomes. So is God's word.
Amen.
The more you chew it, the saliva of the Holy Spirit acts on the spiritual food, the spiritual manna, and the more ready it is to nourish you up in your spiritual life. Kula, 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 neno la Mungu. Hivyo, nitaka tukuwashukuru waimbaji. Ningeweza kuzungumza nanyi mengi kidogo kuhusu neno la Mungu. Kanisa leo inabidi likumbushwe sana. In fact, vijana wetu, sana. Mnaangalia kinachotokea ulimwenguni leo. Ya kwamba it's turmoil everywhere.
Sure.
It's hate, it's anger, seeking to do revenge. You can even talk about protecting the gun, right? Gun rights. Amidst what is happening. You wonder. Lakini usishangae, consider anarchy was the result.
Sure.
Moral decay was the order of the day. It cannot be different in our generation. There's gotta be a people who will stand and say, these are eternal values. These are God-given values. They are timeless. They were true yesterday. They are true today. They will remain true forever and ever. They originate from Him who is truth, the source of truth. And I believe wakati umefika, those of us who claim to stand by the Bible, to be very clear and stand for what the Bible teaches. Kwa sababu, giza linapokuwa nene, nyota ndio zinang'aa zaidi.
That's true.
The darker it gets, the brighter the stars. Yes, wanasema.
Yes.
You are the light of the world.
Yes.
Kwa hivyo, wale ambao tuna nuru ya Yesu Kristo, ikiwa tutanyamaza na nyakati kama hizi, hakuna tumaini kwa ulimwengu. Lakini tukisimama kwa ujasiri wa Roho Mtakatifu, wapo wengine ambao wamekata tamaa lakini watapata tumaini.
Yep.
Usimwaibikie Yesu Kristo.
Sure.
Don't you be embarrassed of the values that you stand for. Those are eternal values. Stand for them, preach about them, talk about them. Model the values that God has given us. Kwa sababu, ikiwa tuko nyumbani, kuna baba na mama na watoto. Wamekaa mezani wanakula. Alafu inatokea nyoka kubwa. Inakuja inaingia kwa mlango wa mbele. Watoto wanaona nyoka. Nyoka, nyoka, nyoka! Wanakimbia. Wanakwenda bedroom. Nyoka inaendelea kuja. Mama naye anasema, nyoka! Nyoka! Naye anakimbia. Bedroom wanafunga mlango. Wamemwacha baba peke yake. Sasa baadaye, wanaona baba naye anakuja anakimbia. Nyoka, nyoka! Naye anakimbia anaingia ndani. Kuna tumaini kwenye hiyo nyumba?
No hope. Kuna.
Watoto ndio wanakuwa hoi kabisa. Mama naye anasema sasa nani atatuokoa? Hakuna tumaini. Mungu ametupatia nuru. Stand up for Jesus.
Amen.
Simama. Simama, not politically. Simama by modeling. Be an embodiment of the values that God has given to bring harmony and peace. And eternity to humanity. This is your time. Whom you are at with. Na ndio maana we spend time to come here together, to meditate together upon God's word. Let's be cognizant of the times we live in. Because who are we? Sisi ni nani? Mabalozi wa Yesu Kristo. Tuimbe ule wimbo kidogo. Mzee wangu njoo tusaidiane. Napenda kitabu chake kilichotoka.
Yeah.
came here on earth. By the way, he found the very people that are called by his name, those whom he had appointed to be his special people, whom he said, you are my treasured possession, they were living under terrible oppression. Hopelessness had captivated them, and they were not sure. And even after he had grown up and had started working, Jesus Christ, when he came for the first time, the Bible is full of evidences that he went through all the towns and villages. He taught people in the synagogues. He preached unto them the good news of the kingdom. He healed every disease and a sickness. But today I want you to know, and if you will forget anything that I will say here this afternoon, remember this, it all was from compassion. Uh-huh. Everything that Jesus did as service to mankind was driven by compassion. I bring this because yesterday we said, ambassadors, you have been appointed for service. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. The reason you engage in service is not that you may get credit from him who appointed you. That should not be the motivation. In fact, you will only engage in service to humanity because you are driven by the same thing that drove Jesus into action. Compassion. Compassion. I bring this because a Seventh-day Adventist, and it's something that is true of the Laodicean church, there is some kind of pride. You know our pride? Yes. Let's talk about ourselves. What is our pride?
We have it all, man.
I mean, they're not like us. We've got it. Sometimes we go evangelizing just to prove to them that we've got it. That's the motive. The better than thou attitude. That's not how Jesus ministered amongst us. He was moved by genuine concern. He looked at them and saw trouble. He saw disease. He saw discouragement, disappointment. And his heart was touched. I say this. If we approach service from the right angle, there is no limit to what we can do on behalf of Jesus Christ.
Amen. Yeah. Amen. That's true.
If we approach it from our own angle, I can only go this far. Jesus had compassion on them. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them. Because he says they were confused and helpless, like sheep without shepherds, scattered hopelessly everywhere. No aim, no goal, no objective, no purpose in life. Life ceases to have a meaning. And he sees it. I walk down streets of towns today. I see masses of people walking up and down. I ask the question, where are they going? But I'm also going. Where am I going? But then I pause for a moment to look on the faces of people. By the way, they tell the story. They tell the story. Look onto the faces of people. They tell the story. You can't miss it. You don't have to be the psychologist. You don't have to be. You will see it on their faces.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
When you see it, what does it do to you? When Jesus saw it, he had compassion on them. And when Jesus saw the confused and helpless, just imagine this, he said also, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. By seeing what their faces reflected, he did not only see their dejection. He did not see the turmoil they were in. He did not only see the diseases, but he saw windows of opportunity for the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Sure, that's true.
For the truth, for the everlasting gospel, the good news. For when man is downtrodden, Good news is the answer.
Mm-hmm.
What longs for, looks for, anticipates somebody would come out with good news. And thereby Jesus would say, wow, the harvest is plenty. But also lament that the workers
are
few. I want to propose, they are not few in number. They are few in the quality of the people that are needed to engage in such a ministry. My proposal is, the world probably doesn't have as many compassionate people anymore. With what I see inside my church, the struggles we have amongst ourselves, I dare say probably even within the church, there are few of us who are pressed with compassion. And Jesus would say, there is a lot of work out there to be done. But where are the compassionate?
Mm-hmm.
Where are the genuinely concerned people who see trouble, who see pain, and they cannot rest, they cannot contain themselves, they are attracted to action.
Mm-hmm.
For compassion is more than sympathy.
Mm-hmm.
Far more than sympathy, but compassion is far more than empathy. I know empathy is a little more than sympathy, but compassion is powerful. So Jesus saw the multitude and he had compassion on them. On Matthew chapter 14:14, Jesus saw the huge crowd as he stepped from the boat and he had compassion on them and healed their sick. Jesus replied, they do not need to go away. You give them something to eat. By the way, this is a day that the disciples had expected a failure because God had sent, Jesus had sent them after training them first, and then he sends them out. And then when they come back, they come back babbling with good stories. God, the Holy Spirit worked amongst us. And Jesus said, okay, stop. Don't tell me we need to go to a place B just by ourselves. And then I will hear the stories. But you know, because of what Jesus was, a compassionate leader, wherever he passed, people followed. So even though they were retreating to a place of rest, in no time a huge multitude was there. And they stayed with Jesus the whole day. I guess the disciples were kind of disappointed. You mean we can't have private time with Jesus Christ? He's the master. All these people are coming. So when they had sat the whole day, the disciples come and say, Jesus, I think you need to send people away. Send them away. You mean people who came to Jesus Christ, you send them away? I called you to be fishers of men. Is it the work of fishermen to send the fish away?
Mm-hmm.
You never catch a fish. You never catch a fish. So that was a failure. And Jesus would say, okay, I hear you, but listen, give you them something to eat. They thought they had posed a challenge on Jesus Christ. And Jesus Christ came back, straight talk. You give them something to eat. You have been under training for so much time. You mean you can't feel for these people just that they are hungry? You can't feel for them? It doesn't trouble you at all? It doesn't trouble? You don't feel responsibility that you have something to do for a people who have voluntarily come to sit at the feet of Jesus? They have left their businesses. They have found in Jesus something that supersedes everything else they see. And now want to be in the presence of Jesus. And the best you can come with is to send them away. You have no compassion. Give them something to eat. Feel for the masses of people in the needs that they have. Take responsibility, for compassion does not shy away. Compassion does not pass by. Compassion engages. The compassionate heals. They feed. And And the disciples, sometimes they just don't know what to do, but to say, set them away. You know, I could be, during this time and in this generation, the 21st century, I could be one of those disciples whose philosophy in life is, don't get involved if it's somebody else's responsibility. Yeah. Not mine, but somebody else. And Jesus would say to me today, Geoffrey, listen, even in the 21st century, give them something to eat. It's more than food. Mm-hmm. God is saying to me, you've got to change. You've got to have the right attitude. You've got to be a real ambassador of mine. For I, your master, am a compassionate God. So Jesus called his disciples to him and said, I have compassion for these people. They have already been with me 3 days and have nothing to eat. I do not want to send them away hungry, or they may collapse on the way. So you can tell Jesus was not just putting some artificial compassion. This was something that was coming from inside. I do not want to send them. You can see the passion there. These people are hungry. I just do not want to send them out hungry. They may collapse on the way. And if they collapse on the way, the story will go out. They have been with Jesus. And Jesus did nothing. And so the disciples asked the question, where could we get enough bread in this remote place to feed them? Sometimes we are full of excuses. And some of the excuses are very intelligent. Mm-hmm. They are actually true. Yeah, out in the wilderness, where do you get bread? No flour? No shops around? Where do you get bread? In this story, it's very interesting. For every excuse they gave, Jesus remained firm. Give them something. Give them something. Give them something. And if Jesus was drilling something powerful in the disciples, I have been with you. And you can't say even in the wilderness there is nothing, or there is nothing enough, when there is a God.
Yes.
Do you know your God? How can you say there is nothing enough? Where is your God? Where is your God? Give them something to eat. Give them something to eat. Where is your God? You look into your bank account, not enough. You look at what you have in your wardrobes, in your fridge, in your cupboards, not enough. And Jesus would remain the same. Give them something to eat. I'm not rich, Lord. I'm not rich. You know I'm not rich. It doesn't take rich people.
Mm-hmm.
It takes men and women of faith.
Yes. Yep.
Who know their God. Mm-hmm. We talked about knowing God yesterday, experientially. This is it. It takes men and women who know their God and who trust in that God, who have faith in that God, and they will walk the walk of faith.
Yes.
Knowing that even though I don't have, but God has.
Yes.
And to this God, I will look. And you know, there were two of these blind men. Jesus and his disciples were leaving Jerusalem. A large crowd followed him. Two blind men heard that he was passing and they called aloud, Lord, son of David, have mercy on us. Then the crowd did what we do today. Shut up. This is an important man passing by. You blind people. Shut up. Yeah, somebody said yesterday, I think I had somebody say, they come knocking at our door, then we call 911. not with the ambassadors of Jesus Christ. So whereas everybody else rebukes, Jesus stops. Then calls them. And he asks them, what do you want me to do? And what was the answer? One thing. We want our sight.
Mm-hmm.
We want to see. And that Jesus had compassion on them, the Bible says, and they touched their eyes. Immediately they received their sight, and they followed him. He was moved by compassion. And where everybody rebukes, everybody looks down upon the needy, everybody avoids the needy, Jesus, driven by compassion, responds to the needy. Jesus would expect the ambassador, his ambassadors today, to emulate their master. A disciple got to be very close to his master, to be like a master. A man with leprosy, Mark 1, 40, 41, a man with leprosy, an outcast, rejected, condemned to die. He comes begging for cleansing, and this is quite a story. He's filled with compassion. Jesus reaches out his hand and touches him. I am willing. Be clean. And immediately, leprosy. And you know the famous story. By the way, Jesus was going out of the city of, little city of Nain. And in that city, Jesus was coming into the city with the disciples. And in the city, a lady, a widow, had lost her husband, but now also lost the only son who was her only hope. And as Jesus was coming into the city, the pallbearers were carrying the body of the little son. They were going out of the city to go and bury the son. And then Jesus, as always, his eyes fall on the lady who has now lost her last hope. It was enough. It was not good to lose her husband, but to also lose the only son. She's a loner, and what a life. Many had come comforting her. By the way, some of them were hired mourners who would cry, not because they have compassion, but because there is money behind that.
Mm-hmm.
Crocodile's tears.
Sure.
They were there. And that these were the people who were making noises as the procession went to the grave. Jesus comes to the disciples and his eyes falls on the lady who is needy. I understand. I understand. And he walks straight to the lady, and the message was, stop crying. And the lady is like, who is this guy? Stop crying. Does he know that this is my only son? Jesus does not enter into the argument, seeing the doubt on her face. And he walks directly to the pallbearers, puts them to a stop. And Jesus says, son, rise. Can you imagine the joy there was? When Jesus takes the boy back to her mother, the tears of pain turn into tears of joy. They cannot be contained. Compassion does not ignore, does not pass by. Compassion observes, takes note. Compassion reaches down deep the heart of the compassionate. And the compassionate is when thrown into action. Compassion is of such a nature that if you don't do anything towards what you have seen, you will not be at peace. At night you will not sleep. Your life will be messed up. You are only free when you do something for somebody whom you're compassionate towards. That's why Jesus was filled with compassion. Filled with compassion, Jesus reaches out and he says to the leper, be healed. Luke 7, a widow of a dead being taken to burial. And Jesus says, okay, Here is your son back. What a joy. The greatest example we have in the Bible is the Good Samaritan. The two came and saw the same scene of a man who had been wounded and was nearing death. The first two passed by. But when the Good Samaritan came, he observed, and what he saw touched his heart. He couldn't go on with a business trip. He stopped, took his bandages, bandaged the wounded. He also took his oil, and it no longer had to be his oil when there is somebody who is in need more than he is. So he takes the oil and he treats the wounds. First aid. He takes his Mercedes Benz, the donkey, and puts the man on the Mercedes Benz. Sometimes when I have a nice car, don't pull a poor man in. He will make my car dirty, smells bad. When we have no compassion, we become a terrible breed of animals. Terrible.
Yes.
Terrible. How do you see wounded? I would have shown a clip today, but I thought it would take time. A dog here in North America, it was captured in the CCTVs.
Mm-hmm.
A dog which was trying to cross a highway was hit by a car, and it lost its hind leg, so it lay on the road, helpless. There was another dog on the other side of the highway. It saw a wounded dog in the middle of traffic, suffering. And this dog amazingly decided to risk its life. Went into the traffic, dodged the fast cars until it got to the wounded dog. And when it got to the wounded dog, instead of using its teeth to pull the hot dog, it used its front legs, slowly by slowly, dragging the wounded from the traffic.
Mm.
At that same time, people in their cars, this was a nearly six-lane highway. Everybody was busy just chomp, dodging them. Nobody dared stop. Probably could say this is a dog. But we have treated fellow human beings likewise. Wounded, hurt. It may not be physically, but psychologically as well. But we have dared not, we passed by. The ambassadors of Jesus Christ will be filled with compassion just as Jesus was filled with compassion. I dare say, the ambassadors of Jesus Christ will also engage in evangelism, not because they are better than others, not even because they have something better than others, because they have compassion. They're seeing what the devil is doing towards his creatures. And they say, how can it be? How can it be? And they're motivated by what they see, they join their master to serve those in need. Who are we? Nimalize na kisa hiki. Nilikuwa hapa US, nilisoma zamani. Some of you may remember, it was on River Potomac, Maryland. The plane was taking off, full with passengers. And as it took off from the ground, somehow, instead of gaining altitude, it began losing altitude. In the end, hitting its tail on a bridge. It was during the cold months of the year, and the passengers were poured into the cold waters of River Potomac. The bridge was not broken, and therefore cars were passing over. Some stopped and looked over the bridge. There were cries, cries of sympathy. There were even cries of empathy. Nothing more. Nothing more. A man and his wife, two daughters, also stopped. When he saw what was happening, listened to the cries, he said, "It doesn't help to cry. They are dying." He went to his wife and said, "I must do something." Kissed his daughters, and they jumped into the cold waters. Took their time to take those who were almost frozen and now connect them to the lifelines, because the boats have come, helicopters have come. And by the time the lifeline hung on him, he was gone. That is compassion. The harvest is plenty, but the reapers are few. I invite you to enter the mind of the one who appointed you. Think seriously about it, and let the Holy Spirit instruct you on what you need to do. And God bless you.